I started Angel's Envy in my basement, and the plan was to have a small craft brand I could work on with my father and my sons. And lo and behold, we managed to launch it in probably the biggest resurgence of the bourbon market we've ever seen. So it's been an amazing ride taking Angel's Envy from my basement into a 90,000 square foot distillery. The most important part, however, is that we need to maintain the magic that made Angel's Envy what it was and what it is, and that I never lose sight of the things that made us successful. I'm Wes Henderson, and I am the co-founder and chief innovation officer at Angel's Envy Whiskeys. I think with scalability, there's a lot of moving targets happening in this industry right now. The industry has exploded. Anybody that says 15 years ago they knew where the industry was going to be today is full of shit, because there's no way they could have possibly known. Certainly you have to plan, you have to have some plan in place, but the big challenge for us as a brand is to, as we grow, how do we manage to preserve the magic that got us where we are? And you want to have cost savings where possible, but you never want to sacrifice the originality, the creativity that got you where you are. And that's an ongoing challenge. I think everybody here has seen what, you know, as you grow, the growing pains that come along with that.
Angel's Envy was acquired by Bacardi, correct?
Correct.
Was it always the goal? Was that always the goal when you founded Angel's Envy, was to sell, or did that evolve, and did your views on that change over time?
It evolved. The original reason behind starting it was, you know, I wanted to do something with my father. Dad was a 8-year melanoma survivor. I felt in the back of my mind that maybe that would eventually come back. I wanted to do something with him. That was the thought process. A small craft distillery, just the family working, and it just evolved from there. Things started growing. We had some friends in the Bacardi family, and they're a family brand. They know a lot about distilling. They've been doing it for over 150 years. It was just a good fit.
Yeah.
And we've been blessed that our parent company fully supports what we do. They know we make good whiskey. They support us every way they can. I know that's a long-winded answer, but no, we had no clue what we were going to do. And I'm just glad things evolved the way they did.
Well, and at the end of the day, I mean, we all know what we like, and we're creating these things that we think other people would like. But the real measuring stick is, you know, you can sell that first bottle to somebody in a kind of captive situation, but are they going to come back and get that second bottle and that third bottle?
And that's a really good point. You have to be in tune, not just with your own creative thought process, but if you want a brand to be successful, you're thinking it all the way down the line. You're thinking of how the consumer's going to receive it. You're thinking about how you're going to, at least I do, how we're going to market it, all those things. And I think you almost have to do that.
Scarcity plays into it as well. So if you're a new distillery, there's only so many bottles of it. So I think that's where, you know, a lot of times you're able to get away with a little bit higher price. Because, I mean, if you can go anywhere in the United States and get a particular bottle from one of the larger producers, it's just not as special, and it allows smaller producers to demand that higher price.
And don't you think consumers also really appreciate the stories behind smaller producers? And, you know, I know starting Angel's Envy was just a crazy ass idea to move 6 kids, 2 dogs, 2 birds, a fish and a bearded dragon up from Florida to Kentucky, just on a crazy idea, right? So. But that's our DNA. And to be able to share that and add something to the discussion, and everybody here has a wonderfully unique story about how we got where we are. And sharing bourbon and sharing spirits is all about, I believe, just as much about the ritual and the storytelling as it is about what's in the glass. So, you know, there's a premium for that as well. And people are willing to pay that premium as long as you're delivering, you know, great stuff.